Windows Pro Edition. Whether you have Windows 10 or 11, you might be wondering if it's worth the extra $100 over Home Edition. If you look on Microsoft's website, it makes it look like the difference is BitLocker and that's it, but there's quite a few more features that are exclusive to Pro. So what I'll do is first go over all the main differences between Pro and Home, and then at the end, I'll also go over some free alternatives to a lot of these features, because pretty much all of them do have a free alternative, so maybe you don't need to spend all that money. And if you didn't know, you can actually upgrade to Pro right from the Microsoft Store, and interestingly, here it does show quite a few more differences, but still not all of them. First up, we have the Group Policy Editor, which basically lets you change a massive amount of settings behind the scenes in Windows without having to go into the registry to change anything. I could go on all day about the hundreds of settings in here. There's just too many to talk about. Most of them are actually not that useful to the average person. A lot of them have to do with features that are enabled and disabled in Windows and user permissions, because it's mostly meant for businesses to easily set up computers for a company all in the same way, and you can just apply a group policy. That's why it's called that. But still, it covers so much different stuff that at one point or another, you'll probably find something you can find it useful for. Next up, we have Windows Sandbox, which is actually really cool. And it basically is a temporary virtual machine that you pop up and then you can do whatever you want in it. And it's a regular looking Windows installation. And then when you close the window, it's all gone and nothing you did in there makes a difference. And more importantly, the main idea is it's isolated from your main Windows installation. So it's good for checking out maybe suspicious files. You're a little bit on the fence whether you think you want to trust it, or maybe you just want to make sure that the program does what it says it does instead of having to install it and then uninstall it and making a mess. Of course, if you are genuinely suspicious about a program, it's best to just not run it at all. The sandbox is also a lot easier to use than setting up a whole virtual machine, for example, using another feature that I'll talk about in a second. You literally just run the Windows sandbox, it pops up, it's all ready to go, and then when you close it, it's ready for the next one. It just erases everything for next time. Now, speaking of virtual machines, the next feature exclusive to Windows Pro is Hyper-V, which lets you make full-blown virtual machines. You basically will download a ISO installer just like you would for a regular computer, and then you can install an operating system onto the virtual machine. So it's definitely not as plug and play as the Windows Sandbox, although I will point out that Microsoft does actually host virtual machine disks that are pre-made for developers, so you can actually download that, but that's like 30 gigabytes. Maybe you don't want to have to worry about downloading huge files. But of course, a virtual machine is a lot more versatile and can do a lot more than just being used as a sandbox. You can run any kind of operating system like Linux. Maybe you want to just try out Linux, or maybe you want to use some programs that are exclusive to another operating system. Or in my case, even though I'm running Windows 11, maybe I want to show something in Windows 10 or a lower edition of Windows, so I have multiple virtual machines that I can load into and see. And Hyper-V does have a lot of advanced options for configuring the virtual devices and stuff like that, so you really can do whatever you want, but if you're not what you might consider an advanced user, then you might have some trouble figuring everything out. All right, now if you've watched me for a while, you know that I'm really obsessed with computer security and privacy and all that, which is where today's sponsor comes in, Delete Me. It's a data privacy service, which I myself have been a paying customer to for over 2 years now, long before they ever sponsored. If you've ever Googled yourself, you definitely have seen the countless so-called data broker websites who not only collect and display all your personal information, like name, address, and phone number, but they even sell it to companies to do whatever they want with it. But that's where Delete Me comes in. They do all the hard work, and their experts will submit removal requests on your behalf. And new data brokers pop up all the time, so Delete Me is constantly adding new ones and continue to monitor them and repeat removals if your info shows up on a site again, which can happen a lot. At the moment, they automatically scan and remove from 67 different data brokers, and you'll get a privacy report for which sites you were removed from after 7 days of signing up and every 3 months after that. So you can see exactly which sites are clean with your info and which ones have removals in progress still. But that's not all, because you can also submit custom requests where a specialist will go and request removal from hundreds of other sites, even surprising ones like berkeley.edu, for example. It's not even a data broker, but Delete Me will still help you get removed from it if you're on there for some reason. So if you want to get your personal information removed from the web and search results, go to joindeleteme.com/TheoJoe and use the promo code TheoJoe for a nice discount. And I'll put that link in the description as well. And with all that being said, let's continue. Okay, next up we have the Local Users and Groups Management Console. This is a really minor one, but I figured I'd mention it anyway. It basically is just a GUI for managing user accounts in a few ways that would otherwise require using the command prompt commands, like enabling and disabling user accounts, changing a password policy, that kind of thing. Up next, we have BitLocker, which you may have heard of before. It allows you to encrypt the entire OS installation drive and any other secondary drives of your computer, so everything if you want. You basically set up an encryption key that you want to make sure that you store and don't lose, because without it, you literally won't be able to access your computer if you have to use it. Or you also have the option to save it to your Microsoft account, which for most people is probably what you want to do. The encryption and decryption is all done on the fly, so theoretically it should have no noticeable impact on performance. And there's also a feature called BitLocker to Go, which lets you encrypt an external drive, and then it can be used on any other Windows machine, as long as it's relatively recent enough to be able to use BitLocker. I will point out though that there is a separate feature called device encryption, which is available to home users. It just has a lot less options. Basically, from my understanding, is it simply only lets you encrypt all or nothing, not like BitLocker where you can choose the OS drive and then however many secondary drives, if any. The next feature is remote desktop, which lets you remotely control an unattended computer, and unattended is a key word there. Home Edition users can still act as a client for a remote desktop connection, meaning they can be the one accessing the remote machine, but the one being the server basically being accessed must be Pro. And the reason I emphasized remote desktop can be for unattended computers is because Home Edition Windows actually does have a really cool feature called Quick Assist, where you can remotely control another device, like to help someone out, but they need to be there to accept the connection. And you also have to enter a code, so it's not like you can use that to just remotely connect to a computer whenever you want. I believe Quick Assist should be pre-installed, but you can also get it from the Microsoft Store if necessary. And the final ones, before we get to the free alternatives, are mostly having to do with business stuff, so most people are not going to be interested in this. But for example, you can join an Active Directory or a company domain, so these are going to be for computers that are managed by a company, as well as you're able to access a private catalog of your company software on the Microsoft Store if they have one. So a few business-oriented features there. All right, now, like I said, there's actually free alternatives to basically all of these features, so you don't necessarily have to get Pro if you don't want to have the native feature version. First, a free alternative to Windows Sandbox is a program called Sandboxy Plus, and it's really cool because unlike a full virtual machine or even Windows Sandbox, the idea is you run individual programs isolated within their own sandbox. So basically, you right-click a program and hit Run Sandbox, and then it isolates it into a sandbox and prevents it from making permanent changes to your computer. And you could tell it's sandboxed by a yellow border when you move your cursor near the top. So say you run your browser sandboxed, like here with Chrome, and you download a picture somewhere. To Chrome, it'll show up there, but it won't actually show up there to anything else outside the sandbox. But Chrome still thinks it was saved there. And even if you open the photo, the photo viewer will pop up also in the sandbox, separate from the system still. And if you hit to show the folder through Chrome, it opens up Explorer in a sandbox and still shows it there, even though running Explorer outside the sandbox, it doesn't show up. So there's a bunch of features, and this makes it really useful in addition to Windows Sandbox, actually, because it can do cool stuff like even forcing certain programs to always open in a sandbox if you want it to be secure. And I could probably make a whole video about the uses for this program, but pretty cool, just check it out. Now, if you do want to use a full-blown virtual machine, a free alternative to Hyper-V is VirtualBox, which is free and open source, and it's actually owned by Oracle, so there's a big company behind it, and it has a lot of professional features. And one cool feature is you can actually select an ISO and do a unattended install of certain operating systems. Like with this one for Windows 10, you just set a few initial settings, and then it will go do the whole thing automatically. So for most people, this will definitely be more than enough. Next, as an alternative to Group Policy Editor, there's actually a program called Policy Plus. I made a whole separate video about it, so I'd recommend really watching that. But basically, it has a very similar interface to Group Policy Editor, but you can run it on any edition of Windows. Keep in mind, even though I believe it will show all the same policy options as the Group Policy Editor, there are quite a few where even if you change and enable it or disable it, it won't actually activate behind the scenes because whatever that feature is truly requires the Pro Edition. So just be aware of that. To get some of the stuff, you really do actually need to have Pro. As an alternative to BitLocker, like I mentioned, there's the Windows device encryption feature, which should be in the settings and you can search encryption and it should come up. For me, it just goes to BitLocker because I do have Pro or higher. But if you just want to simply encrypt your whole device, then this is probably the way to go. Though, if you're looking for something more advanced, there's also another free open source program called Veracrypt, which not only will let you encrypt an entire computer or drive, but also create encrypted containers that you simply store on the computer like a file, and it's encrypted until you decrypt it in one of whatever ways you set. There's a lot of advanced stuff here, so not exactly user-friendly if you're not familiar with that kind of stuff, but good to know about. Finally, as an alternative to remote desktop, there's a lot of options actually. The first one, like I mentioned, is Quick Assist. It's built into Windows, and basically it's good for helping friends. The person doing the connecting just has to sign into a Microsoft account, and then you type in a code, and you can access that person's computer. It's just not built for continuous connections, so once you close it out, that's it. It's not like you can keep reconnecting to someone, unless they initiate the connection separately every time with a code. Though, of course, if you do want something closer to remote desktop, there's several options out there. So one of them is TeamViewer, which is free for personal use, and you'll pretty much get a lot of the features in there. And there's another technology called VNC. So there are several of these that are VNC programs, but probably the main one that I would recommend that seems the most polished is called RealVNC. And it's a paid app, but they do have a free Lite version. It's called VNC Connect Lite. And I'm pretty sure that does all the basics that you would probably need to do anyway. That's free for personal use, so that's one to check out. Basically, what you do is you host a VNC server on the computer you want to connect to, and then you'll use the VNC client to connect from another computer, and then you can remote in, see the screen, that sort of thing. So I think those are the most significant differences for the average person. Let me know what you think down in the comments. Do you think it's worth it to get Windows Pro just for those native features, or are you fine using open source stuff? And thanks again to DeleteMe for sponsoring this video. Again, if you want to get your personal information removed from data brokers, go to joindeleteme.com/TheoJoe and use the promo code TheoJoe for a nice discount. If you want to keep watching, the next video I'll put right here is that one that I talked about for Policy Plus, the Group Policy Editor alternative. If you want to see a lot more details about that, you can just click on that right there. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.